Welcome back to Lecture 2. I hope that the self-reflection activity was helpful as you start to reflect on what are the needs within your organization. Let's continue on with how do we design a good needs assessment and what is our framework for that design. So as we talked about, in phase one of the needs assessment, we're trying to identify the needs. And we're doing that on several levels. Now we'll continue on to use that same logic model results framework approach to look at how do we design a needs assessment that has all the components to be successful. So as we laid out, there's this relationship that we're looking at between these gaps and results. And in phase one, we used it to identify the gaps. And now in phase two, we're then asked the questions as to why do these gaps exist? What are the root causes that are keeping us from achieving the results that we really want to accomplish? And this can be done in two parts. The first part is to ask the question, why is the gap? The second part is to start to analyze the relationship between the gaps. Is closing one gap really necessary for accomplishing another gap? Remember that in our definition of need, a need is the necessary relationship between these two gaps. If the first gap in results that we had labeled B is not really necessary for accomplishing C, the second gap in results, then it's not a need. We may really want to do it, and it may be results that we really want to accomplish, but it's only a need if it is actually necessary in order to achieve the second. So if we think back to our example of Rose, she cannot achieve improved heart health without first accomplishing the reduction in her cholesterol. And in the case of Mimi, she's looking to determine whether or not she can meet client demand with or without having that increase in team productivity and teamwork. If Mimi determines that improving teamwork is not really necessary to meet client demand, then it is no longer a need. She may still decide to do it and that she wants it, but it would no longer be a priority need within her needs assessment. So these are the key questions that we struggle with as we start into phase two of doing the analysis phase of our needs assessment. In the third phase, we then want to look at how do we close these gaps in results? How do we shift from the results we're currently accomplishing to a point where we're accomplishing the results we really wanted to accomplish? And then what are the relationships of those? Within that framework, our needs assessment then has to collect data and information. And this is what really provides the structure for what you'll do within your needs assessment. Each of those boxes represents information that has to be gathered. Sometimes it's already collected by others, sometimes we have to collect it ourselves. But each of those boxes is data. And we have to determine, do we have the data or do we have to collect the data? Is the data verifiable? Can we confirm that it is what the people say it is, or do we have to rely on their perspectives or their perceptions of what the reality is? And also, is the data qualitative or quantitative in nature? All of these questions will help us define what has to be done within our needs assessment. So if we have to collect data about what outputs are currently being accomplished, we can then look to see what data is available, can we verify that data, or is it just going to be the perception of that data, and is the data qualitative or quantitative in nature? Similarly, we can collect data about what should be the outcomes, or what should be the impacts. So for each of those boxes, we can think about them as a data element that either has to be collected or we can use already collected data to fill in. And again, we do that for phase one of identifying those needs. We do it again in phase two, where we gather data about why the needs exist and are those needs really necessary in relationship to each other. And then we also look for data and information to support how we're going to close those gaps. As we think about how we're going to close those gaps in results, we're starting to look forward. So we're making hypotheses that if I implement an activity, it will get a result. And if I get that result, it will bring us about another result. And this is good. This is how we learn within our institutions. We form hypotheses based on information and experience, and then we test those hypotheses in reality. So as we start to think in terms of our needs assessment, we have to form our ideas around what are the hypotheses that we'll have in terms of solutions for closing those gaps in results, and then how can we ensure that everything we use leads to very efficient processes, and those processes lead to the desired output. And the outputs contribute to desired outcomes, and the desired outcomes lead us to the desired impacts on our community and society. And in this way, now we have a structure for designing our needs assessment. It goes across all three phases, from identifying needs, to analyzing needs, to deciding what to do. And it happens across our results framework. It happens at the impacts, the outcomes, and the outputs level. And we also look at the activities and the resource levels to look at the gaps between what it is that we're currently doing and what it is we should be doing in the future. With that in mind, now we can see that we've been able to define what our needs assessment is going to accomplish. And we're starting to have a design framework that will allow us to go about conducting a needs assessment. In lecture three, we will pick up from here and we'll talk about what are the tools that we'll use as we conduct our needs assessment. These are the tools that will help us fill in each of those boxes in our framework that we just looked at. Before we move on to lecture three, though, I would like you to pause the video and to do another short reflection activity. For this activity, I want you to identify a project or program that you are working on currently. For that project or program, I want you to write down what it should achieve. And I want you to write it down at the three levels that we've discussed. What are the impacts it should achieve, the outcomes it should achieve, and the outputs that it should achieve. Once you've written these down and you're starting to better understand the results and the relationships between those results for your program or project, I want you to ask yourself two basic questions. What are the assumptions that you're relying on that link together the outputs to the outcomes and the outcomes to the impacts? What are you assuming that will lead from the output, such as a training program, to the desired outcome, such as increased productivity? And can you trust that assumption? Or are there other factors at play that you must be aware of? And the second question I'll ask you to consider is, what data will you require to validate the current and desired levels of each of these results? Again, we want these to be measurable results, and so we want to have information that can verify that these are accurate perceptions and that the data will support our decision-making going forward. After you've completed the self-reflection activity, you can continue on with lecture three of this e-learning course on discovering needs.